When the Feast of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Without warning, there was a sound like a strong wind, gale force. No one could tell where it came from. It filled the whole building. And then, like a wildfire, the Holy Spirit spread through their ranks, and they started speaking in a number of different languages as the Spirit prompted them. There were many Jews staying in Jerusalem just then, devout pilgrims from all over the world. When they heard the sound, they came on the run. Then, when they heard, one after another, their own mother tongues being spoken, they were thunderstruck. They couldn't, for the life of them, figure out what was going on, and kept saying, "Aren't these all Galileans? How come we're hearing them talk in our various mother tongues? They're speaking our languages, describing God's mighty works." Their heads were spinning. They couldn't make head or tail of any of it. They talked back and forth, confused. "What's going on here?" Others joked, "They're drunk on cheap wine." That's when Peter stood and, backed by the other 11, spoke out with bold urgency. "Fellow Jews, all of you who are visiting Jerusalem today, listen carefully and get this story straight. These people aren't drunk, as some of you suspect. They haven't had time to get drunk. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning. This is what the prophet Joel announced would happen. In the last days, says the Lord, I will pour out my spirit on every kind of people. Your sons will prophesy, also your daughters. Your young men will see visions, and your old men dream dreams. When the time comes, I will pour out my spirit on those who serve me, men and women both, and they'll prophesy." Acts chapter 2. Bethlehem was God with us. Calvary was God for us. Pentecost is God in us. We worship the one who is with us, the one who is in us, and we say, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here, and so are you. Let's worship him now.
Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing your praise. O rushing wild Spirit of God, pour out the fire of love upon us. Unfurl your language upon our lips. Unlock our minds to embrace all possibility. Unleash our hearts so your justice flows freely. O for a thousand tongues to sing your praise.
O rushing wild Spirit of God, pour out the fire of love upon us. May your breeze bring health and wholeness. May your breath heat our resolve. May your spirit storm the earth with mercy and grace.
Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing your praise. O rushing wild Spirit of God, pour out the fire of love upon us. Set us free from self-doubt. Make us listeners as we seek awareness. Shake us awake when we forget our privilege.
O for a thousand tongues to sing your praise.
O rushing wild Spirit of God, pour out the fire of love upon us.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Well, our lockdown as a family started probably a week earlier than most people's. We went to a wedding. 3 days later, we all went down with those flu-like symptoms, which probably most people would assume to be coronavirus now. We weren't tested, but pretty sure it was. Josie had it pretty bad. Me and Owen, well, bit of man flu, really. And Lydia didn't have anything at all. Other thoughts? Haircuts. If you had said to me 8 weeks ago, Owen's going to be cutting your hair, I probably would have laughed in your face. Well, I don't think he's done too bad a job. He had a go at it last weekend, and I think he's done pretty good. I know I'm not that particular, my sense of style is pretty awful, but I'm pretty proud of it. I can live with it just as well, and it does grow. Table tennis, I've been getting some practice in, Lydia and Owen being practicing with me. I'm looking forward to thrashing Andy Sharp when I get a chance to finish lockdown. So beware, Andy. Working. Well, I've been working throughout this last 8 or 9 weeks, wherever it's been. I've been really busy, actually. Probably some busiest I've been for, well, years, actually. It's strangely coincided with this period. I'm kind of fed up with using those collaborative tools like MS Teams and Skype and Zoom. I'm really desperate to meet people face-to-face again in the office. That would be really nice. But one thing I'm not missing is getting up at 10 to 6 each morning and not getting home before 6. I'm finding it difficult now to get up at 10 past 7, let alone 10 to 6. The other thing I'd utter these words, but I'm actually missing the commute. After 30 years of commuting to Croydon and London, I actually miss that little bit of banter with passengers in the morning, other people I travel with, and just having that quiet time, reading my book. And I used to sort of pray as well on the train. All that routine's been thrown out. It's been a little bit hard to readjust to a new routine, but I'm getting there slowly. We've been working at home together as a family. We've had me, Owen, and Lydia. When Josie comes back from visiting patients, she writes up her notes. So 10 Newham Lane, it's been quite a little busy little office. Other thoughts, I've been reflecting on this lockdown and how it affects other countries. I've been really grateful for living in the UK. Dig a little bit deeper on the websites and newspapers, you suddenly realise how lucky we are. Places like Pakistan, India, Africa, and we heard last week from the pastor in Cuba, if you don't work, you don't earn money. If you don't earn money, you have nothing to buy food with. That's a pretty desperate situation. The other one is a really big one, that is the economy. Every day we hear people being made redundant, and we're not talking about a couple of hundred, sometimes thousands. And probably at the end of this, we will have unemployment like we had back in the 1980s, which is a pretty frightening thought. So I think as a community, we're going to have to adjust to those kind of levels of unemployment and understand how that affects us as a community and how we can probably work in that as the hub. So anyhow, there's some thoughts. Thank you for listening.
Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for Howard, Josie and their family. We pray that you would give them continued good health at this time. We pray that you will be with them as a family as they share together in all aspects of being locked down together, the everyday chores, hobbies, gardening and table tennis. We pray too for them individually as they adapt to all the changes in their daily routines and working environment. We pray that you would encourage them as they discover new ways of communicating and sharing with work colleagues, friends and family. We pray, Holy Spirit, that you would bless each of them with your love and protection at this time. May you bless them and keep them close to you. In Jesus' name. Amen.
So when the apostles were with Jesus, they kept asking him, Lord, has the time come for you to free Israel and restore our kingdom? He replied, The Father alone has the authority to set those dates and times, and they are not for you to know. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. After saying this, he was taken up into a cloud while they were watching, and they could no longer see him. As they strained to see him rising into heaven, two white-robed men suddenly stood among them. Men of Galilee, they said, why are you standing here staring into heaven? Jesus has been taken from you into heaven, but someday he will return from heaven in the same way you saw him go.
The eagle-eyed among you will have noticed that I've merged together both Ascension Day and the Day of Pentecost. When we started our time together, I retold the story of the coming of the Holy Spirit. And then Andy read for us the story from the chapter before in Acts chapter 1 about Jesus ascending into heaven. Because I want to handle these two stories together. Because one of them is about the promise of Jesus that comes in Acts chapter 1. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes. And then we see it delivered on the day of Pentecost. Just one more chapter, chapter 2 of Acts. The Spirit does indeed come. You know, I imagine after the resurrection of Jesus, the disciples would have been pretty exhausted. They'd been on an emotional roller coaster, not just then, but for the previous years. And maybe they had a bit of a chance to process some of what had been happening to them. They went through the agony of Jesus' death and the shock of the resurrection. But now the resurrected Jesus is with them again, and it's a bit like the good old days. It seems a bit different though. But I can imagine those disciples wanting their old lives back with Jesus, wanting the stories and the teaching back, wanting the crowds and those heady days of miracles and walking on water, the days before the horror of the cross and the shock and surprise of the resurrection. And maybe that's behind the question the disciples ask. Okay, Jesus, when are you going to finish what you started? When is your kingdom going to come and Israel will be set free? And who could have blamed them? After all that they witnessed, after all they had seen and experienced, they had been in self-imposed lockdown. They were shielding themselves from very real dangers in the world. But now Jesus was back, and perhaps things could get back to normal. But Jesus tells them there will be no going back, only going forward. There will be a new normal, a normal which won't be about recounting the good old days, but writing great new days, even better days, where Jesus is with them in a new and powerful way. Days when the Spirit comes, where there is a new work to be done. A work, of course, which continues in our lives to this very day. This Spirit is the very breath of God, the playmaker of God, the kiss of God. The Spirit not sent to make their lives more bearable or to take the edge off the sadness of life. You will receive power, Jesus promises, power. And by witnessing even to the ends of the earth, God's kingdom will come as men and women, boys and girls, indeed all of creation is set free in justice and love. Not just Israel, but everything. Birthed by the Holy Spirit of God in them. So when the Spirit comes in Acts chapter 2, when the promised invasion takes place, it turns these scared disciples into sacred missionaries, this motley collection of betrayers and deniers and doubters. They're set on fire by heaven itself. And they start proclaiming in word and deed the wonderful things that God has done. And then Acts continues with event after event after event of these men and women so caught up in the presence of God, in this great dance of power and love, that for 28 exhausting chapters of Acts, we see the works of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit doing extraordinary things through very ordinary people. The Holy Spirit doesn't come to make us feel good. But because the life to which we are called is impossible to live without God's power pulsating through our veins. This same Spirit is the Spirit that danced with the Father and the Son over all creation. and then filled the temple of creation with his holy presence. The Spirit that danced with Abraham and Sarah and birthed Isaac and promised that great things would happen. The Spirit that led the people by fire and cloud to be God's people, a people separate for God himself, to reach all peoples. The Spirit is the Spirit that danced with the prophets, taking them to their communities to cry out, "Return to me," says the Lord. The Spirit is the Spirit who danced with the Virgin Mary and gave birth to Emmanuel, the very God with us, through whose sacrifice at Calvary showed that not only was God with us, but that he's for us, and that he will make us temples too, places where the dance will continue in these new temples, not made with stone and gold, but with flesh and blood. Men and women, the crown of creation, indwelt by the power of all powers, by the love of all loves, by the presence of the Holy God, to live as, to be witnesses. It's the promise of Pentecost. Witnesses to the reversal of the judgment, that if the Tower of Babel was the judgment which confused peoples with languages and sent them scattered across the world, so the Pentecost languages shows that renewal and revival are here, restoring and bringing creation back together, that the dancing Spirit of God who blows whenever and however and wherever God chooses. The one who comes to us again too. Not just to assure us of God's presence in lockdown, though he does. Not just to convict us of our need for God's grace, though the Spirit does that too. But that as God's love transforms us as new temples where heaven and earth meet, we are little Christ transforming those around us. We are the new world order, with nothing to lose and everything to give away, because now we are caught up in the great dance of Father, Son and Holy Spirit. Pope Francis writes, "The Holy Spirit bothers us because he moves us, he makes us walk. He pushes the church to go forward. We want the Holy Spirit to doze off. We want to domesticate the Holy Spirit, but that's no good because he is God. He is that wind which comes and goes where you don't know where. He is the power of God, the one who gives us consolation and strength to move forward, but to move forward, and this bothers us. It's so much nicer to be comfortable." You know, what kicked off in Jerusalem that day continues in our homes this day. Let's invite the Spirit to come to us again, to dance in our lives again, to bring transformation and power, that we might live as places where heaven and earth meets. St. Simeon's prayer says, "Come, true light. Come, life eternal. Come, hidden mystery. Come, treasure without name. Come, reality beyond all words. Come, person beyond all understanding. Come, rejoicing without end. Come, light that knows no evening. Come, unfailing expectation of the saved. Come, raising of the fallen. Come, resurrection of the dead. Come, all-powerful, for unceasingly you create, refashion, and change all things by your will alone. Come, for your name fills our hearts with longing and is ever on our lips. Come, for you are yourself the desire that is within me. Come, my breath and my life. come the consolation of my humble soul. Come my joy, my glory, my endless delight.
Your spirit is a gentleman standing at my hidden doors within. Where you wait for me to let you in, so you can set me free.
One by one, I watch them fall, till you are all I see. You are the life in me.
You're the life in me.
You're the air I breathe. Change in me.
You're the change in me.
You are the change.
You're the change in me.
Your spirit is a whispering when all the lies are deafening. You speak to the very heart of me, and fear cannot remain.
Your spirit is the light ahead, calling me into the depths. And daring me to take a step and let you lead the way.
Life in me.
You're the life in me. Oh,
you're the air I breathe.
You're the air I breathe. Oh, you're the change in me. You're the change in me.
Your spirit is a holy flame, burning all the old away. Here I am, Lord, have your way, till all that's left is you.
You're the life in me.
The air I breathe.
You're the air I breathe.
Oh. You're the change in me.
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 Your spirit is my constant friend.
You're with me.
You're with me to the very end. I'll never be alone again.
I'll never be
alone again.
I'll never be alone again.
You're the change.
You're the change in me.
Flaming God of Pentecost, let us speak in tongues of comfort to those weeping over the bodies of their loved ones, shot by troubled gunmen, killed in border clashes, dying from Ebola.
Let us speak in tongues of courage to those living in fear of the next shooting, the next bomb, the illness that threatens. Let us speak in tongues of condemnation against laws and policies that promote violence, prioritising the preferences of some over the lives of others. Let us speak in tongues of care for the most vulnerable in our world, human beings, animals and ecosystems. Let us speak in tongues of love for you and for your people, that your language might be our language.
And when our tongues are still, when we have no words to speak, let our hearts burn with your fire. Let our ears hear your words in our own native tongue. Let our skin feel the wind of your spirit, a mighty wind blowing where it will. Amen. Amen.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and evermore. Amen.